Hello, welcome to my channel. This program is the following program uses read to input and display the contents of a file that contains ASCII text. So the name of the file is specified as a command line argument. So here is the program. Here we are importing java.io and file name is public show file, and this you already knew about public static void. And here's the data type and file input stream fin. So then first confirm the file has been specified with this code, then attempt to open the file. We are using this code, and at this point file is open and can be read. So the following reads character until end of the file is encountered. So as we are using try and cache and close the file. For closing the file, this code is. So for closing the file, we can use finally also, or file close to try with finally. So this is the code. So you can use this code also, or this, because in none program finally is used once, but we can use as many as catch statement with try. So either here only one finally is used, but try, catch, and finally or catch can't be used together. So this question is with try and catch. Basically this is a these questions are not used in real life applications, but this question came in exam. So for exam purpose this is very important, so that's why I'm showing this. So in the program, notice the try-catch blocks that can handle input-output errors that might occur each input-output operation. It's monitored for execution, and if an exception occurs, it is handled. So be aware that in simple program or example code, it is common to see input-output exceptions simply thrown out of the main, as was done in the earlier console input-output examples in our previous video. Also, in some real-world code, it can be helpful to let an exception propagate to a calling routine to let the caller know that input-output operation failed. For most of the file input-output exception examples, we are using IOException explicitly. So, although the preceding example closes the file stream after the file is read, there is a variation that is often useful. So, the variation is to call close within a finally block. In this approach, all of the methods that access the file are contained within a try block, and the finally block is used to close the file. So this way, no matter how the try block terminates, file is closed. So assuming the preceding example, here is how the try block reads the file can be recorded, and this is the example of finally block. Although not an issue in this case, one advantage to this to finally approach in general is that if the code that accesses a file terminates because of some IO related exception, the file is still closed by the finally block. Sometimes it is easier to wrap the portion of a program that open the file, access the file within a single try block rather than separating the two. So, and then use a finally block to close the file. For example, here is another way to write a show file program. So let's see. So this is so this program is here. So here is int data type file input stream fin null, and first confirm that the file has been specified, and try file input stream and this. So this code is there. for catch you can use this, for finally this you can use this code also, except this. So finally always use at end. So let's go to this, and this is also a program program to display. So let's see, here is a import java io public static void class show file 1. So this program name is close class name is file 1. So this program is you can see this error occur, file not found and char and this. Okay, so let's see first copy file. For copying the file we are using this type of code. And so in this program, notice that two separate try blocks are used when closing the file. This ensures that the both file are closed even if the call to finclose throws an exception. In general, notice that all potential IO errors are handled in the preceding two program by the use of exceptions. So this differs from what some computer languages that use error codes to report file errors. So not only do exceptions make the file handling clear, but they also enable Java to easily differentiate the end of file condition from the file errors when the input is being performed. So automatically, how to automatically close a file. So here is the a program for automatically close the file. This is the program to close automatically file. First confirm both files have been specified. Okay, then this code. So this code is very not, number of lines are very less in this code. So in the program, pay special attention to how the file is opened with try statement. Notice how the resource specification portion of try declares a file input stream, and which is then assigned a reference to the file opened by its constructor. Thus, in this version of the program, the variable fin is a local to the try block being created when try is entered. When try is left, the stream associated with fin is automatically closed by an implicit call to close. So you don't need to call close explicitly, which means that you can't forget to close a file. This is a key advantage of using try with resources. It is important to understand that the resource declared in the try statement is explicitly scope of the resource is limited, and the try with resources statement. You can manage more than one resource within a single try statement. To do so, simple separate each resource specification with semicolon. So following program shows an example. It reworks the copy file program shown earlier so that it uses a single try with resources statement to manage both fin and fout. So let's see another program. So this is the program used with the resources. In this program, notice how the input and output files are opened with try block. So you can see this code. Okay. So after this try block ends, both fin and fout will have been closed. So if you compare this version of the program to previous version, you will see that it is much shorter. There is one other aspect to try with resources that needs to be mentioned. In general, when a try block executes, it is possible that an exception inside try block will lead to another exception that occurs when the resource is closed in a finally clause. So in the case of normal try statement, the original exception is lost, being preempted by the second exception. However, when using try with resources, the second exception is suppressed. It is not, however, lost. Instead of it is added to the list suppressed exception. And with the first exception, the first list of suppressed exception can be obtained by using get suppressed method defined by throwable. So now our next question is, this so let's see. Then next is transient. What is transient? So let's talk about transient here. So Java defines two interesting type of modifier, transient and volatile. So these modifiers used to handle somewhat specialized situations. When an instance variable is declared as transient, then its value need not be persist when an object is stored. For example, in this example, class t will not persist, but transient int a will persist. Oh, there is no this. So int here is a b will persist, and int here is a will not persist. So here, if an object of type t is returned to persistent storage area, the content of a would not be saved, but the content of b would. So the volatile modifier tells the compiler that the variable modified by volatile can be changed unexpectedly by other parts of your program. One of these situations involves multi-thread programs. In a multi-thread program, sometimes two or more threads share the same variable. For efficient consideration, each thread can keep its own private copy of such shared variable. So the real or master copy of the variable is updated at various times, such as when synchronized method is entered. While this approach works fine, it may be inefficient at times. In some cases, all that really matters is that the copy of the variable always reflects its current state. To ensure this, simple specify the variable is volatile, which tells the compiler that must always use the master copy of volatile variable, or at least always keep any private copy up to date with master copy, and vice versa. Also, access to master variable must be executed in precise order in which they are executed on any private copy. So I think you can better understand with this explanation. Then this is an instance of. Sometimes knowing the type of an object during runtime is useful. For example, you might have one thread of execution that generates various type of objects and another thread that processes these objects. In this situation, it might be useful for processing thread to know the type of each object when it receives. Another situation in which knowledge of an object type at runtime is important involves casting. In Java, invalid cast causes a runtime error. Many invalid casts can be caught at compile time. However, casts involving class hierarchy can produce invalid casts that can be detected only at runtime. For example, a superclass A can produce two subclasses B and C. Thus, casting B object into type A or casting C object into type A is legal, but casting B object into C or vice versa is not legal. Because an object of type A can refer to object of either B or C, how can you know at runtime when type of object is actually being referred to attempting the cast to C? It would be an object of type A and B, C. If it is an object of type B, runtime exception will be thrown. So Java provides a runtime operator instance of answer this question. Here the instance of is the means by which your program can obtain runtime information about an object. So in short, we can say instance of is the means by which your program can obtain runtime information about an object. So this is a program, you can see here, class A, B, C and C or D extends. So they are inheriting the qualities of A. Okay, so this is an example of inheritance also, or instance of. So this is the example of instance of. So you need to know about the instance of and how you can use. Okay, so let's go to another example, and this is a strict FP. There is no example of strict FP, but I want to explain this. With the creation of Java early version, the floating point computation model was relaxed slightly. Specifically, the new model does not require the truncation of certain intermediate values that occur during a computation. This prevents overflow or underflow in some cases. By modifying a class, a method or interface, the strict FP, you ensure that the floating point calculations, thus all truncations, take place precisely as they did in earlier version of Java. When a class is modified with strict FP, all the methods in the class are closely modified with strict FP automatically. For example, the following fragment tells the Java to use the original floating point model for calculation in all methods defined within class. For example, strict FP class myClass. Frankly, most programmers never need to use strict FP because it affects only very small class of programs. So our next example is native methods. So I think you are familiar with this word native. So although it is rare, occasionally you may want to call a subroutine that is written in a language other than Java. Typically such subroutine exists as executable code for the CPU and environment in which you are working. That is native code. For example, you may want to call a native code subroutine to achieve faster execution time, or you may want to use specialized third-party library such as statistical package. Or however, because Java program are compiled to bytecode, which is then interpreted or compiled on the fly by the Java runtime system, it would seem impossible to call native code subroutine from within your Java program. Fortunately, this conclusion is false. Java provides native keyword, which is used to declare native code methods. Once declared, this method can be called from inside your Java program, just as you call any other Java method. To declare a native method, precede the example with native modifier, but do not define any body for the method. For example, public native int math. You can see this example also. So after you declare a native method, you must write the native method and follow a rather complex series of steps to link it with your Java code. So most native methods are written in C, so the mechanism used to integrate C code with a Java program is called Java Native Interface. So detailed description of JNIs is beyond the scope of your course, but the approach described here provides sufficient information for simple application. So here is the Java code, and this is the C code. Okay, so Java Native Interface. So you can use with the cmd command. Okay, so let's and see the C program here. So this is the C program. So our next example, next topic is, let me explain this better. Notice that the test method is declared as native, as nobody, this is the method that will implement in C shortly. Also notice a static block explained earlier in this book. Static block is executed only once. So our next topic is, we are not going into the native because this is not relevant topic. I gave you this short program here. Now our next topic is assert. Another relatively new condition of Java is the keyword assert. It is used during the program development to create an assertion, which is a condition that should be true during the execution of program. For example, you might have a method that should always return a positive integer value. You might test this by asserting that the return value is greater than 0 using an assert statement. At runtime, if condition is true, no other action takes place. However, if the condition is false, then assertion error is thrown. Assertions are often used during testing to verify that some expected condition is actually met. So they are not usually used for releasing code. So assert keyword has two forms. The first shown in this program. So here's a assert demo. Static int value is 3. Static int get now. And this. So this is the example of assertion. To enable assertion checking at runtime, you must specify minus EA option, for example, to enable assertion for assert demo. Execute it using this line. Java, I am talking about CMD command prompt. So where you can write Java minus EE assert demo. So let's go to another. So our another topic is static import. Static import. What is static import here? Java includes a feature called static import that expands the capability of the import keyword. By following import with the keyword static. Import statement can be used to import the static members of a class or interface. When using static import, it is possible to refer the static member directly by their names without having to qualify them with their name of their class. This simplifies, shortens the syntax required to use static member. To understand the usefulness of static import, let's begin with an example that does not use it. The following program computes the hypotenuse of right triangle. It uses two static method, math.pow, which returns a value raised to specified power. So the second math.squared, which returns the square root of its argument. So this is the very compute the class is hypot and public static void string, double site 1 and 2. Then this is the method math squared. So because power squared are static method, they must be called through the use of their class name math. Okay. So at this example illustration, having to specify the class name each time power or squared. So or any Java other method such as sin, cost and is used can grow tedious. You can eliminate the medium of specifying the class name through the use of static import as shown in the following version of this program. So this is the program here. We are importing a static Java lang math SQRT and in static Java lang math pow. Okay, so compute the hypotenuse of right triangle. So okay. So here SQRT and pow can call by themselves and without their class name. So in this version, the name SQRT and pow are brought into view by this static import statement. So after this statement, it is no longer necessary to qualify SQRT and pow with their class name. So therefore, the hypotenuse calculation can more conveniently be specified as shown here. So our next topic is invoking overloaded constructor through this. So this is a simple program. You can see here. Okay. So how we are invoking this? Let's see. So here is public class my class. In this version of my class, the only constructor that actually assign value to the A and B field in my class N. So the other two constructors simply invoke the constructor either directly or indirectly through this. For example, consider what happens when the statement executes my class MC and my new class. So you can see here. So now talk about some compact API profiles. These are called compact 2, 3. Each profile contains subset of library. Furthermore, compact 2 include the compact 1. And thus each profile builds on previous one. The advantage of compact profile is that application thus does not require full library need to download it. So using compact file reduces the size of library and enabling some type of Java applications to run on devices that could not otherwise support the entire Java API. So the use of compact profile can also reduce the time it takes to load a program. So Java API documentation indicates to which, if any, profile each API element belongs. So when compiling a program, you can determine if a program uses API defined by a compact profile or by using the profile option. So here's a general form. Java C profile, profile name and program name. Here profile name specify the profile which must compact 1 and compact 2 and compact 3. So Java C profile compact 2 test.java. So here the compact 2 profile is specified and the test.java contain API that is not a part of compact 2. Then a compilation error will result. So our next topic is generics. In our next video, we will cover the topic of generics. And after generic, string handling, lambda expression, and after that, applet. Okay. Thanks for watching.